We invite you to stand with us once again as we sing about our foundation, Jesus Christ.
Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness, Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all. From the dead, conquering fear, our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness, Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. Lord, we
Thank you, praise team, for leading us in worship this morning. You may or may not be aware that October 18th will mark the 75th anniversary of this church. According to the historical records, on October 18th, 1947, a duly called council comprised of representatives of North American Baptist churches met to examine the request by a group of believers who were meeting together here in Swan River. The request was to become an organized church. Prior to that meeting, several things had been done to bring the church to that moment, or to bring that group of believers to that moment. After a thorough examination, the council recommended that they proceed with the plans to officially organize as a church, and thus later that day, Temple Baptist Church came into being. To celebrate our 75th anniversary, beginning next Sunday and continuing each Sunday leading up to October 18th, we will highlight in our worship services various aspects of our church history And all of this will culminate with a church family fellowship meal. Considering this milestone in the life of the church, I thought it would be appropriate to spend the next several Sundays examining what the Bible has to say about the church and consider its ramifications for our fellowship. Scripture uses several metaphors to describe the church. Although this is not an exhaustive list, the church is referred to as a body, as a building, a marriage, and as a family. And what do these metaphors have in common? What is similar to each of them? What they have in common is this. Each metaphor is comprised of many parts which make up the whole. The body is comprised of many parts, hands, feet, eyes, legs, heart, and so forth, and each contributing to the wholeness of the body. Many bricks are necessary in the construction of a building. In a biblically based marriage, a man and woman become husband and wife. And in a family, there are parents or a parent along with a child or children. And so each metaphor emphasizes that many parts make up the whole. But they also point to something else. They also emphasize that each part is necessary, and there are consequences if one part of the whole doesn't carry out its function. There are repercussions if a part of the body doesn't function properly or at all. Or if a few bricks are removed from a building. Or if one spouse doesn't uphold the marriage vows and or leaves the marriage altogether. Or if a family member refuses to contribute to the well-being of the household. Each of these metaphors, then, emphasize a very important truth. The church is better together. Despite our shortcomings, our imperfections, and our flaws, we are better together. And even though we sometimes wound each other and ignore each other and chafe on each other, we are better together. And so it's this theme that I wish to develop in the coming weeks. To begin, I thought it would be helpful to begin by asking a very basic question. What is the purpose of the church? Legendary football coach Vince Lombardi of the Green Bay Packers recognized the importance of getting back to the basics. In July 1961, 38 members of the Green Bay Packers football team were gathered for the first day of training camp. The previous season had ended with a heartbreaking defeat when the Packers squandered a late lead in the fourth quarter and lost the NFL championship to the Philadelphia Eagles. The Green Bay players had been thinking about this brutal loss for the entire offseason, and now finally training camp had arrived and it was time to get back to work. The players were so eager to advance their game to the next level and start working on the details that would help them win a championship. Their coach, Vince Lombardi, had a different idea. In his best-selling book, When Pride Still Mattered, A Life of Vince Lombardi, author David Moranis explains what happened when Lombardi walked into training camp that summer day. He took nothing for granted. He began a tradition of starting from scratch, assuming that the players were blank slates who carried over no knowledge from the years before. And so he began with the most elemental statement of all. "Gentlemen," he said, holding a pigskin in his right hand, "this is a football." Lombardi was coaching a group of 36 professional athletes who just months prior had come within minutes of winning the biggest prize their sport could offer. And yet he started from the very beginning. I recognize this morning that I am speaking to individuals who have been part of the church for a long time. And yet I think this is a question that we need to ask, that we need to come back to often. What is the purpose of the church? For what purpose does the church exist? Sunday after Sunday, we walk through the doors of this building, gathering as followers of Jesus to worship God and spend time in fellowship. But do we know why we do this? Do we pause to consider our purpose? It is important to emphasize that I'm not talking about the universal church, which is comprised of all Christians of all times and places. Rather, I would have us focus on the local church. What is the purpose of the local church? Why do we gather in local congregations? Again, recognizing the church is not a building, but it's a group of believers, those who have been redeemed by Jesus, who come together. Asking that question to a variety of people would evoke a variety of answers. One response to that question might be that the church exists to worship God. But what does it mean to worship God? Because that can mean different things to different people. Some would suggest that the primary purpose of the church is to evangelize the lost. And others would be adamant that the church's primary task is discipleship. There would be those who would argue that the church's calling is to uphold justice, to address social issues, social concerns. And still others would respond by saying the church exists for fellowship. Or you may hear someone say, the church is here to meet my needs and the needs of my family. These all sound reasonable, don't they? But which one is right? All of them? Some of them? Or none of them? And so let's consider what the Bible has to say about this matter. Based upon Scripture, God does everything for His glory. And I think that this is clearly expressed in Isaiah chapter 48, verses 9 to 11. To the nation of Israel, who had been unfaithful to God, God said this, "Yet for my own sake and for the honor of my name, I will hold back my anger and not wipe you out. I have refined you, but not as silver is refined. Rather, I have refined you in the furnace of suffering. I will rescue you for my sake. Yes, for my own sake. I will not let my reputation be tarnished, and I will not share my glory with idols." Six statements in these verses that emphasize God's passion for His glory. My own sake, the honor of my name, for my sake, for my own sake, I will not let my reputation be tarnished. I will not share my glory with idols. As John Piper writes, what this text hammers home to us is the centrality of God in His own affections. The most passionate heart for the glorification of God is God's heart. God's ultimate goal is to uphold and display the glory of His name. Therefore, we can conclude that the church exists for God and for His glory. And this is very significant, as Tim Challis writes, When we understand that the local church exists by God and for God, we see that God's glory is meant to be the ultimate determining factor for all the church does. The church does emphasize reaching the lost, and it does emphasize edifying the saved, but it does so in ways that are honoring to God and consistent with His will. It ensures that both the method and the message of the church bring glory to His name. And so that's a very broad and all-encompassing purpose. And perhaps we need to determine what does that exactly mean. Well, I think that from there flows priorities for the church. Mark Dever summarizes them in this way. The proper ends for a local congregation's life and actions are the worship of God, the edification of the church, and the evangelization of the world. These three purposes, in turn, serve the glory of God. And so as a church seeks to honor and glorify God in all they do, here are three priorities that they ought to give their attention to. Now, these three priorities have been stated in different ways, by different people, by different churches, but they all express the same idea. Some have said the three priorities are loving God, loving others, serving the world. Others have said knowing God, serving the church, reaching out with the gospel of reconciliation. Others have described it as reaching upward to God, reaching inward to one another, and reaching outward to believers. Or love God by upreach. Love the church, inreach. Love the world, outreach. So although these three priorities can be stated in several different ways, for our purposes this morning, I'm going to suggest that God is glorified through the church when He is exalted, when saints are edified, and when the world is evangelized. And so let's explore these three priorities in more detail. God is glorified through the church when he is exalted in worship. In other words, the church exists to glorify God through worshiping him. And we worship him in ways he has revealed in the Bible. Therefore, it's not based upon our preferences or our desires, both of believers or unbelievers, but drawn from the revelation of God through his word. Paul in Ephesians says, God has called us to live for the praise of his glory. We are here to glorify and know the God who created us. Peter in his first epistle wrote, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Jesus, as he ministered on this earth, said that we are to worship in spirit and in truth. Unfortunately, there are occasions when we do not worship God in truth nor in spirit. We often worship in the flesh. We equate worship with an emotional experience. As an example, we enjoy the worship music and think that because we've enjoyed it, we've worshiped God. Or we like the ritual of the service and believe God delights in precise form, and so because we followed a ritual or a form of worship, we think we've worshiped. Or we love to hear the word of God taught with power, and we feel the Holy Spirit speaking to us, and we think that because that has happened, we've worshiped God. But is that what worship is? Worship, praise, and glorifying God occurs only when God's word is taught truthfully and our inner beings respond with longing to honor, obey, exalt, and thank him. Just because we have an emotional experience, or just because we've gone through a form of worship, or just because we've heard a sermon doesn't necessarily mean that we have worshiped. There's a response that needs to generate from within to honor, to obey, to exalt, and thank God. He wants our heart to long for him, to seek him. Therefore, we must honor him from our spirit, from inside, with a heart that longs for and reaches out to him. It's in this way that we exalt him. Realize that worshiping God comes as a response to our humble gratitude for his love for us. Knowing God and his character as revealed in Scripture will stir within us, his children, a heart of thankfulness. And that heart of thankfulness is expressed in worship that brings him glory, rather than a self-serving emotional experience. The Spirit causes true worshipers to long to come together with other believers to honor and exalt Christ. So if God's Holy Spirit does not stir in you a desire to worship both privately and corporately, we need to ask why. And so one of the priorities of the church as they seek to glorify God is to glorify him through exaltation in worship. I would also suggest that God is glorified through the church when saints are edified. And who are the saints? The saints are followers of Jesus. If you have been redeemed by grace through faith in Jesus, the Bible calls you a saint. That's your standing. That's my standing before God because of his work of redemption in our life. And as saints, we are to edify one another. Paul in Colossians said that his own goal was not merely to evangelize, but to present every person mature in Christ. And that's the goal of edification, to present one another mature in Christ. And then in Ephesians he writes, he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is ahead, Christ. And so Paul here talks about gifts that are given to the body, to individuals within the body of Christ. And what is the purpose of those gifts? To edify, to build up, to encourage, to help one another come to maturity in the faith. The writer of Hebrews offered this exhortation, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. You see, as Christ followers, we are to consider how we can encourage others, those in our spiritual family, to worship, to love, and to serve God. Therefore, we are to be a part of a church, not simply because of what we can get out of it, but also because of what we can give to it. Not what we can get from it, from one another, but what we can give to one another. And so this means that the Christian life is not just a commitment to Christ. It is also a commitment to others in our church family. Our service is essential to the body of Christ because it contributes to its growth and well-being. Tim Chester and Steve Timmis in their book Everyday Church write, "It is in the family of God that I'm able to care and be cared for. Love and be loved. Forgive and be forgiven. Rebuke and be rebuked. Encourage and be encouraged. All of which is essential to the task of being a disciple of the risen Lord Jesus." And so God uses our interactions with others to show us the areas he would have us repent of, turn from, so that we can reflect the image of his Son. Working alongside Christians in a church fellowship is a wonderful way to grow our love for God and our love for others. And it's also God's way of showing areas that he wants us to mature in as we walk with him. And so God is glorified through the church when saints are edified. But God is also glorified through the church when the world is evangelized. If we are exalting God through worship, if we are edifying the saints, we will naturally want to share the hope of salvation with others. We'll want to obey the Lord. Since Jesus has specifically told us to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, we should do just that. Well, church is first a gathering of God's people. The church gathered can also be a testimony to the unsaved, to those who do not know Jesus personally, as they hear the gospel, as they see it lived out in the lives of Christians. Those churches that become insular rather than evangelistic will ultimately lose their love. They'll lose their zeal and their vitality. And so when it comes to a church's evangelism, D.A. Carson puts it very bluntly. He says, evangelize or die. And J.D. Greer says, without the mission, a church is not a church. It's just a group of disobedient Christians hanging out. Yes, the church does exist to glorify God through exalting him, through edifying the saints, and through evangelizing the world. But in so doing, there are a number of principles that we need to keep in mind. And the first is this: these priorities must be kept in proper balance. We cannot emphasize one at the expense of another. A church that overemphasizes worship at the expense of teaching of Scripture and evangelism will end up with an inadequate Bible teaching for the believer, who will remain shallow in their understanding of Scripture as well as their understanding of the nature and purposes of God. They will also become easy prey for false teaching. And a church that overemphasizes the edification of believers at the expense of worship and evangelism easily minimizes the importance of worshiping God and reaching out to others. It will soon become ingrown and stagnant, for new believers are really the lifeblood of the church. And a church that overemphasizes evangelism at the expense of teaching and worship is in danger of neglecting the teaching of the Word and the worship of God. The church will end up with immature Christians who emphasize growth in numbers but lack true spiritual growth in their own lives. I think these three priorities can be compared to a three-legged stool. What happens if one leg of the stool is shorter than the other? It won't be balanced, and as a result, will not function in the way that it was intended to function. And similarly, a church that is not balanced in these three areas will not function in the way that it was intended to function. The second principle is this: these priorities must flow from the heart of love. Love is a qualifying trait that makes these priorities effective. When we are passionate about Christ, when we are passionate about serving one another, when we are passionate about the world, that is when we make a difference. As an example, Jesus told us that we are to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And so as we gather for corporate worship or in our individual worship, it needs to flow from that love for for God who created us and recreated us in Jesus Christ. You recall in the upper room before his crucifixion, Jesus told his disciples, "By this all men will know you are my disciples if you have love one for another." Listen, disciples, the 11 of you who have now are with me here, you need to love one another. That's going to be a powerful testimony to the world. And so as we edify the body of believers, those that we meet with on a regular basis, we need to do so out of love. And when it came to the spread of the gospel, Paul said, "It's the love of God that controls me." As Paul wrote to the Corinthian believers, he said, "It's the love of God that motivates me to reach out with the gospel." And so the matter of love is essential. Essential as we seek to worship God, as we seek to edify one another, and as we seek to evangelize the world. If love is absent, Paul tells us that we're just a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And so ultimately, the church exists to bring glory to God through exaltation, through edification, through evangelism. Or the church exists to bring glory to God through loving Him, loving one another, loving the world. Or God is glorified through the church when they reach upward, when they reach inward, when they reach outward. However you word it, these are the priorities which flow from our heart of love and which ought to be the purpose, or that feed into the purpose of the church. In a time when people are questioning the value of the church, the necessity of the church, the state of the church, it is important that we understand why we exist and embrace the priorities God has given to us. I said at the outset, I know I'm speaking to people who have been a part of a church, many of you for many, many years. And yet we need to get back to the basics. As Vince Lombardi said to those who gathered on training camp that day, "This is a football." Jesus says to us, "This is a church." You exist as a body of believers to bring glory to God. And you do so through exalting Him, edifying one another, and evangelizing the lost. May that be our motivation as we continue our walk with Him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we know that the church is your idea. You established it. And you do everything for your honor and for your glory. And so, Father, we recognize that there are times we go through the motions of church life without giving thought as to why. Without giving thought to why we do what we do. And so may this overarching purpose, just be impressed and stamped upon our heart and mind that we are here to glorify you. And Father, you've given us three priorities. I pray that we give attention to each of them, that we'd be balanced in our approach, but that we would also carry these out in that spirit of love that you have called us to carry these out with. Father, as we will be observing our 75th church anniversary in next month, I pray that this series of messages, and as we look at our history and some of the important things that have happened in the past, that these would motivate us to continue forward with your power, in the power of your Spirit. And so I commit our church fellowship to you. In the name of Jesus, amen. The praise team is going to come forward and lead us in our final song. And this song, I think, is going to sort of become the theme of this series that I'm presently in, that I introduced to you this morning. And this is Our Church. I pray that we will sing it with passion, with enthusiasm, with conviction, that truly this is the people that God has placed us with, and we want to impact our world and one another for His glory.
We are now a crowd assembled, peace like incense fills the air. men and women, the sounds of children, young and old have come to share in the safety of this place. We have gathered by His grace. This is our church, our family of faith. On this holy ground, we're all the same. And we are the joy of God on display whenever we meet in Jesus' name. Whenever we meet in Jesus' name. Walls are falling, hearts disarming, as His presence ushers in. Waves of mercy fill the building as His Spirit stirs within. In the safety of this place, we have gathered by His grace. This is our church, our family of faith. On this holy ground, we're all the same. And we are the joy of God on display whenever we meet in Jesus' name. Whenever we meet in Jesus' name. From the suburbs and the streets, we have gathered to receive. Some with plenty, some with need, 'cause we are a family, His family. This is our church, our family of faith. On this holy ground, we're all the same. And we are the joy of God on display whenever we meet in Jesus' name. Whenever we meet in Jesus' name.
May you go in God's goodness and grace this week.